Witam Państwa serdecznie, Błażej Hrabkowicz. Jesteśmy na 25. edycji festiwalu Camerimage w Bydgoszczy. Our guest is director, this year recipient of Lifetime Achievement Award, Phillip Noyce. Hello to you.
Hello.
Are you okay? Everything fine?
Great.
Enjoying Poland?
Absolutely.
Are you happy because of the award, or are you...
Am I happy?
Are you melancholic, are you melancholic because of it?
Well, when someone gives you a Lifetime Achievement Award, you know, you start to get suspicious that maybe, you know, they know something that you haven't realized yet. But I'm here to declare that it's not all over, it's just beginning.
Yes, I'm happy because I love a lot of your films and I would like to...
You don't love some others?
I love a lot of your films and I like the rest of them.
Okay,
how is that?
All right, that's
good.
Fine.
But
actually, I don't like them all either.
Yeah, so
I mean, some work out well and some don't. You know,
yeah,
you,
that's the life of.
You start on this journey and often you take the wrong turn.
That's the life of
the
director.
And when you take the wrong turn in movies, you know, it's hard to get back on track.
Yeah. The most films of you that I watched are what we could call genre films, like Patriot Games and Dead Calm and many of them.
So you didn't watch the best ones?
Yeah, the best ones, exactly.
So you didn't watch the best ones?
I watched the best film of yours that I watched is Rabbit Proof Fence.
Oh, okay. Well, which that's is not a genre film, is it?
It isn't. But what I wanted to ask you is that many filmmakers say that genre filmmaking is very difficult because of you have to be very precise, you have to have great attention to detail and to logic of the script, and you have to be very strict with the story because otherwise the genre doesn't work really. Would you agree with that, and what is your experience here?
No, that's true, but as an Australian, born in Australia, growing up in Australia and going to Hollywood when I was over 40 years old, genre films were a natural migration point because to do genre films that rely mainly on the creation of tension, the telling of big stories, the clash of people in politics, in war and so on, you don't have to rely so much on an understanding of the cultural specifics, which is always difficult for an outsider in America. So you tend to get offered genre films, and it's only by going back to where I came from that I was able to get out of that genre trap.
Yeah, but
prison, genre prison,
genre
Hollywood prison.
Prison,
yeah. Okay. They pay you a lot of money and lock you up in genre films.
Okay, but do you believe that genre films can also be a useful platform to tell something?
Oh, sure,
something
sure.
More? I mean, like many great directors did it.
That's the trick.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, what can you do with the limitations of the genre?
Yeah.
How can you bend the subject?
Yeah,
and so on.
Yes. Did you, when you were making your genre films, did you try to play with the rules a little bit?
Yeah. Of course. I mean, for example, I was visiting the Navy Yard in Washington with my kid who was 12, and we were there to see all the latest gadgets they had for protecting people, and I went off with Harrison Ford. And so, but my daughter couldn't come, and so she was looked after by some naval officer. Anyway, later I met back with her, and I said, what did you do? And this was back in 1991. She said, oh, I was watching Cuba. I said, you're watching Cuba? What do you mean you're watching Cuba? She took me in, and I looked on the screen, and there was like they were watching all these people that were glowing, and they were walking around inside Cuba. And of course, she had been introduced to American early satellite heat recognition.
Yeah, yeah.
So immediately we put that in the movie, in Patriot Games.
In Patriot Games, yeah, Harrison Ford's on Patriot
Before
Games.
Before the first Gulf War, when we all saw it, she had already seen it. So that scene became a comment on modern warfare.
Yeah. Your daughter got a sneak peek.
She got a sneak peek and she
modern
told me,
means of invigilation and observation.
Exactly.
Yeah. We mentioned Rabbit Proof Fence already, and you mentioned that you went back to Australia to sort of get out of the genre trap that you were put in by the Americans.
Well, I was willing participant, you know.
Yeah, I know.
They weren't torturing me or anything.
The evil Americans didn't just torture you and
put you in the
trap.
No, they gave me all sorts of inducements.
Yeah,
I would eventually imagine. Not any inducement could keep me there.
Yeah, you came back and you did Rabbit Proof Fence.
Rabbit Proof Fence, actually, was in the middle of the night. The phone rings, There's a woman, she sounds completely crazy. She says, I have the script that you were born to make. I said, lady, everybody tells me that, but they tell me in the middle of the day, not the middle of the night. She said, you have to read my script. I said, okay, all right, why don't you ring back and to my office during the day? Yeah. So the next day I went to the office, I told my assistant, I said, listen, there's this crazy lady, she's gonna ring up, she's gonna say that I should read her script. Just get rid of her, keep her out of my life. Anyway, the lady was new to the job. She was African-American, and instead of obeying me, she did the opposite. She got talking to the other lady, and she invited her to send the script. She read the script, and then she wouldn't stop pestering me. For 3 months, she said, you must read this script. This is my assistant. So, you must read the script.
So you had two people now pestering you about the script.
And I said, no, 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 this crazy woman, no, no, no. And then finally, after more than 3 months, I read the script. And immediately I was seized by the idea of going back home, which was the story of the film. I knew that, like the three kids in Rabbit Proof Fence, I had to take a long journey to find myself and to find my mother.
I have to say that this is a brilliant film, in my opinion, because it is in some ways adventure film. These two kids going in a sort of adventure, but in the background you have all we have all these dark political and social things. Of course, the discrimination and the Aborigine fate in Australia. Was it because of that factor also that this was really important to you, the social and political factor?
Because it asked questions that I had never bothered to ask, or I'd wanted to ask in the back of my head, because growing up in every Australian town, as I grew up in a small town, actually where they make a famous wine called Yellowtail, you might have seen it, that's where it comes from, my hometown. 13 million bottles leave there every year. Some come to Warsaw, but...
Does it sustain economically the whole town?
No, marijuana sustains the town, mainly. But the wine is a good second.
Like many towns in the world.
Yeah. Growing up in Australia in the 1950s, outside the town was this other population. They'd been herded and put inside what we called a reserve. In America, they called it a reservation. In America, it's used for Native Americans. In Australia, for Native Australians. And so everyone was kept there, and we didn't think about them. We didn't have to. And these were the original inhabitants. And so when I finally was tortured enough by my people around me to read this script, I said, I got to make this story because it's asking questions that need to be answered.
Do you believe that to this day, this is your most important film? Do you regard this as the most important film?
Unfortunately, yes.
Why unfortunately?
Well, you know, you'd always like to, it was one of the cheapest.
Yeah.
Didn't cost much. It was the most successful in terms of what it made compared to the budget.
Had also a great soundtrack by Peter Gabriel.
Peter Gabriel.
He's a genius.
Been asking him ever since. He won't come back again. You know, he said once is enough. Maybe because I paid him nothing. But that was his choice.
Yeah.
And it caused a great change in the Australian people and government. So, you know, that's hard to beat, no matter how much money they pay you.
Yeah, well, you said that this is only a beginning, not the ending. So we will hold you to your word.
Oh, yes.
We're waiting for another,
it won't be Rabbit Proof
Fence.
Next films. It'll be a war movie.
Yeah.
I know you've got too many war movies in Europe, but this one's not in Europe, it's set in Libya.
And too many wars also.
Yeah, too many wars, but it's the same war that we keep going back to in Europe, the Second World War.
Yeah.
But it's the story of a massive victory by my father.
Oh.
Not only, he was assisted by 15,000 other Australians, and they defeated the Afrika Korps of Rommel in Libya, in a town called Tobruk, which has since become famous because of Gaddafi and things that are going on there. But this was a 9-month siege, which was eventually won by the Aussies, the boys from the bush.
Okay, we're waiting for that film, and thank you for this conversation.
Okay, thank you.